to you, withholding nothing, withholding nothing. I surrender all to you, everything I give to you, withholding nothing.
I first of all want to give honor to my life, Savior Jesus the Christ, who is the head of my life, and to tell you that it's good to be here. And I'm like one of the hymnologists who said, I'm glad to be in the service one more time. You didn't have to let me live, but I live to be in this holy place, here in this sanctuary, one more time. Amen. 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 I honor God for the angels of this house. Dr. Anita and the other clergy, assistants, all of the clergy in the house, and to all of the officers and members and friends, grace and peace be unto you. And God our Father in Jesus Christ, our Lord. Thank you, my classmate. Thank you, my sister Gaskins, for not going through all of that stuff. Amen. But it's just good to see you. It's good to have classmates that still love you and know you. And I was talking to a pastor in the back and said it's hard sometimes to pastor at home and to be a minister in on home. On town, and people respect you. And I have been blessed to have that respect. And I thank God for that. I thank God for James and the family. And blessing to me was to see Brother Gaskins. God bless you. He and my wife have this thing going, and they like to tease each other all the time and have fun with each other. So it's just good to see you and see you smiling. And I know my wife got to pick at you some, pick on you some, and look back at her when the benediction is given. I'm grateful to have one of my relatives to ride with us coming up. Sister Hodges, Hodges, she rode with us and prayed for us and kept us company, and she didn't tell me I drove too fast. Amen. Just wave your hand, Sister Hodges. Grateful to have my brother who thought he was going to be the baby in the family, but Abraham and Sarah had another idea. And Coleman and Pauline, my sister-in-law. I feel blessed because I have three living brothers, and another week I have three brothers in their 80s, 80, 83, and 86. My sisters are deceased. My oldest sister was 20 when I was born. My next sister was 18, and the next one was 16. So then my three brothers, 13, 10, and he's 7 years older than me. So I'm blessed to be here. So y'all thought I was kidding when I said that there was an Abraham and a Sarah in my house. And I mean, man, I'm in here. Amen. It's the joy in this preaching time. And as you heard my sister Gaskins say, I'm country. And I believe in prayer. Call me country if you want to. That's okay. But I believe in prayer. And I'm a believer that if prayers come from the pews, preaching will come from the pulpit. That's my belief. Because then self is decreased. Self is decreased. And Christ would do the increase here in this place. Because I hope you're here to hear a word from the Lord.
Yes, sir.
I say to my people, when you come in God's house, y'all bring two things with you, at least two. You bring more, but bring two. And they know what they are. I say one, they say other. I say some expectation and some anticipation. Expectation and some anticipation. You ought to expect that God will do just what He says He will do. And you ought to have some anticipation to believe that this day, this Sunday, this time, this service just might be the service with your name on it that you're going to get a special blessing. But even if that doesn't happen, if you come in here and you pray and you brought those two things with you, I'm just foolish enough to believe that the Lord will not allow you to leave here like you can. That's why you see some people come up in here and they don't feel too well, but they press their way in. Somebody to read these scriptures for me, but I didn't do that. So I'll try to read them. I got this little skinny writing here, so I still might have to have somebody come up and read for me. I want two scriptures, and I want you to see them because I just believe that God sent me with a special message today. And I thank God for Bishop Frazier and Dr. Frazier for the invitation and the opportunity to come. Thank you so much. From the New Testament book of the Gospel according to St. Mark, chapter 6. Gospel according to St. Mark. Chapter 6. The text is going to come up from verses 1 through 13. Can I get somebody to come take a mic and read that for me? Can I get somebody to come? Thank you. Come take one of those mics and read that for me. The Gospel according to St. Mark, chapter 6, verses 1 through 13.
Mark chapter 6, starting from verse number 1.
1 through 13.
Yes. 1 through 13. And the word of the Lord reads, "And he went out from thence, and came into his own country. And his disciples followed him. And when the Sabbath day was come, he began to teach in the synagogue. And many hearing him were astonished, saying, From whence hath this man these things? And what wisdom is this which is given unto him, that even such mighty works are wrought by his hands? Is not this the carpenter, the son of Mary, the brother of James, and Joseph, and of Judah, and Simon? And are not his sisters were with us? And they were offended at him. But Jesus said unto them, A prophet is not without honor, but in his own country, and among his own kin, and in his own house. And he could there do no mighty work, save that he laid his hands upon a few sick folk, and healed them. And he marveled because of their unbelief. And he went round about the villages, teaching." Verse 7. "And he called unto him the 12, and began to send them forth by two and two, and gave them power over unclean spirits, and commanded them that they should take nothing for their journey, save a staff only, nor scrip, nor bread, no money in their purse, but be shod with sandals, and not put on two coats. And he said unto them, In what place soever you enter into an house, there abide till ye depart from that place. And whosoever shall not receive you, nor hear you, when you depart thence, shake off the dust under your feet for a testimony against them. Verily I say unto you, it shall be more tolerable for Sodom and Gomorrah in the day of judgment than for that city. And they went out and preached that men should repent. Verse 13. And they cast out many devils and anointed with oil many that were sick and healed them.
Now stay right there. I got something else I want you to read. Before I can have your Bibles open there, I want to live out of this part of the text, verse 4. Verse 4, it says, But Jesus said unto them, A prophet is not without honor, but in his own country, and among his own kin, and in his own house. Okay? For those of you taking note, I want you to note, take that down. Okay? Now flip with me, everybody, to 2 Corinthians. 2 Corinthians chapter 12. 2 Corinthians chapter 12. Second Corinthians chapter 12, verses 2 through 10. 2 Corinthians chapter 12, verses 2 through 10.
2 Corinthians chapter 12, verses 2 through 10.
Yes.
And the word reads, I knew a man in Christ about 14 years ago. Whether in the body, I cannot tell, or whether out of the body, I cannot tell. God knoweth. Such an one caught up to the third heaven, and I knew such a man, whether in the body or out of the body, I cannot tell. God knoweth. How that he was caught up into paradise, and heard unspeakable words, which it is not lawful for a man to utter. Of such an one will I glory, yet of myself I will not glory, but in my infirmities, for though I would desire glory, I should not be a fool, for I will say the truth, but now I forbear, lest any man should think of me above that which he seeth me to be, or that he heareth of me. Verse 7, And lest I should be exalted above measure through the abundance of the revelations, there was given to me a thorn in the flesh, the messenger of Satan, to buffet me, lest I should be exalted above measure. For this thing I besought the Lord thrice, that it might depart from me. And he said unto me, My grace is sufficient for thee, for my strength is made perfect in weakness. Most gladly, therefore, will I rather glory in my infirmities, that the power of Christ may rest upon me. Verse 10, Therefore I take pleasure in infirmities, in reproaches, in necessities, in persecutions, in distress, for Christ's sake. For when I am weak, then am I strong.
For this part of the text, I want to lift up verse 10 that says, Therefore I take pleasure in infirmities, in reproaches, in necessities, in persecutions, in distresses for Christ's sake. For when I am weak, then I am strong. Thank you so much. Let us pray. Eternal God, it's preaching time. Hear it. Speak to and through me, but most of all, speak for me. It is no secret what you can do, what you've done for others. I know that thou canst and will do for me too. So that the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable in my sight, O Lord, our strength and our redeemer, and all the people of God said together, Amen. My subject today is how to fail.
Come on.
F-A-I-A, how to fail.
Y'all look at that stranger. I got somebody's attention today.
I need to tell you from the outset that most people come to church expecting some assistance in learning how to be happy and how to be well-adjusted, and most people want their faith to help them to be successful. But if that's what you come for today, I'm sorry to disappoint you, because rather than focus on how to succeed, I want to look at how to fail. Rather than happiness, I'd rather us to be thinking about rejection today. Yeah. Not that there's anything wrong with happiness and success, because I think all of us would aspire to get to that point.
Is still undone.
Yeah.
Take
in here that's never failed, I'll show you a person that's never done anything. Because if you try and do some stuff, you're going to fail sometimes. Yeah, yeah. Even Jesus himself knew what it was to suffer rejection and fail. I lost somebody then.
He kept on. Yeah. 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 When you try.
children that they need to know that our failures and setbacks do not define us. Failures, our failures and setbacks do not define us. Do not define us. So if you teach it and they don't understand, do this. Let me ask y'all a question. Hit me for a minute. I'm going to give this $20 bill to somebody up in here. Okay? So what I need to know is how many people in here would like to have this $20 bill. Come on now, ain't no tricks, ain't no tricks. Come on, be real. How many people in here would like to have this $20 bill? I'm going to give it to somebody. I'm going to get it. I'm going to get it. I'm standing here preaching. I'm going to get it. Come on, raise your hand. There, raise your hand. Now, wait a minute, wait a minute, wait a minute. How many people in here still want this $20 bill? Wait a minute, 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 wait a minute. How many people in here still want this $20 bill? You gotta pay for it. If you have tried,
talk.
Come on, amen.
But she won't let nobody speak that into her hearing. See, you know you can speak stuff in the being. So Grandmama just kept saying, see, she didn't know she could talk. Grandmama knew, but her baby didn't know.
Amen.
All she knew was my smile living up in my grandmama's mouth. All she knew was, when I get something I want to say,
difficulty, hardship, or we tend to
not want to stick our necks out. We don't want to do anything. We pull back. We avoid the risk. But both Jesus and Paul experienced failure in their life. Paul, as he read that text, for some reason he brought up something that happened 14 years prior to that. And some of those folk there, they wanted him to boast about who he was and all of this, and they had all of these accomplishments and decrees and all of that, if I can keep it real, and they wanted Paul to boast about himself or tell us something about you so we can respect you and if we respect each other. And Paul said, No. If I'm going to boast, I'd rather boast in my infirmities. Because it's when I'm weak, it's then that I'm made strong. If you try, Paul understood. Now he didn't understand at first, because when you heard and read in your presence, when he had a thorn in his flesh, he said, Lord, he went to him three times, remove this from me, Christ. But the Lord said, no, I need you to know that my grace is sufficient. So can it be that some of our prayers need to change a little bit? I'm going to finish up a few minutes. Some of our prayers, rather than asking the Lord every time we see something coming on the scene that's a problematic or trouble and all this stuff, rather than asking the Lord to intervene and remove it and all that, could it be a better prayer to ask the Lord, if this is going to happen, can you give me the strength and endurance? In other words, Lord, you don't have to move the mountain, but if you give me the strength to climb, it'll be all right. Lord, you don't have to take this illness from me, but if you help me to manage it one day at a time, I'll go on with this Lord in my flesh, just like Paul did, because he went on to write most of the Bible, some 16 epistles with a thorn in his flesh, and that the Lord can bless him, and the word said that we shall do greater works than Jesus himself, then we ought to be about our Father's business. Sickened with cancer. She died, lost everything, sleeping on the street, walking, beaten up on himself, sleeping on the street. And one day, he passed a carpenter sitting out in front of a church. And he had it was one of those churches that had a stone in the front. He was whittling on the stone. And he passed by the man at first. Then he said, wait a minute. He said, mister, I hate to disturb you, but can I ask where you gonna put that piece? Because it looks like the church is complete. He said, back up a little bit, sir, and look up toward the cross. And up there, you'll see one final little spot. And the man backed up. He said, oh, thank you, sir. I see it now. And the carpenter looked up in his face while he was speaking.
divinity.
Yes.
At the cross, we see the height of fear and suffering. But the cross has come a symbol of triumph and a symbol of victory and a sign that our failures are not final. And that not even death is final. And that with God, all things, all, somebody say all things, all things, all things, all things are possible. Help me, somebody. Come on, let's give it our hand. Teach these young folk that they're gonna fail.
Yes.
You ain't no big deal.
All right.
Get back up.
Yes.
Try. Baby's trying to teach us that.
That's right.
Yes.
Yeah, we try to teach us that. At one of my church. Just the other week, she was back in the office and she crawled over to the trash can and her grandmother held on to the trash can. And she pulled up. She pulled up. Wasn't ready to walk yet.
Yeah.
After a while, she turned loose and fall back down.
Come on.
Just a few weeks later, y'all know the story.
Yes.
She gonna take one and two and fall back down.
Yeah.
What they gonna do?
Yeah.
And after a while, they take three. And four and after nine, he'd be hollering.
With all.